Roadrunner Rundown on Bakersfield.com and the CSUB Roadrunners Digital Network.
Off the screen, Basil, 2 seconds. Basil for the win! Yeah!
Over to Sydney Haynes off the block, and the Roadrunners
win
it.
Live from downtown Bakersfield, California, here's the voice of the runners, Corey Costello.
Welcome in once again to Roadrunner Rundown, the official program, CESUB Roadrunner Athletics. I'm Corey Costello. Thanks so much for joining us on this election day. Make sure you go and vote. But thanks so much for joining us on the program. We got a great show for you today. We're going to be speaking with CSB President Dr. Horace Mitchell. He will join us on the program for a couple segments, talking a little bit about everything. I mean, he's had a long career at CESUB, a lot of changes. We'll talk a lot about that. And, of course, some of the athletic stuff as well that sort of has benefited the university over the years. So a great conversation coming up with CSB President Dr. Horace Mitchell. So that will be a lot of fun. And then also at the end of the program, we're going to be joined by Logan Bells, our ticketing coordinator with CSUB Athletics, talking tickets for the upcoming season. Men's and women's basketball opens this week, and so Logan will have the details for all those tickets, group tickets, or some special events happening, and so a lot of that going on, and Logan will give us an update of that coming up in the final segment of the program. So great show planned, and we welcome once again here to the show. Let's get to some of the highlights because we were packed last week and a lot of stuff going on. We'll start with men's soccer as the Roadrunners hosting Houston Baptist on senior night. There's one senior, goalkeeper Nicholas Cleaver. Runners needed at least a tie to get into the WAC tournament. Houston Baptist needed a win, so they were pressing early. Nice save early here by Nicholas Cleaver. Hugo Vanalis, the other senior, playing in his final home game. He leads CSUB with 4 games this season. Runners threatened a few times in the first half. Here's Vanalis with the flick into the box, but it was easily saved and knocked down. 21st minute, Jamie Carey Morrell with a worm burner. Look at that missile, but it's just going to go wide. We're still scoreless. Same score in the 29th minute. Julian Zamora earning a little extra space. Nice shot, but it's going to go wide. And we're scoreless as the first half winds down. HBU, another chance, but a chance wasted. This ball's going to sail wide of the net without much of a threat. 43rd minute, things get interesting. Louis Lepuge on the drive. He gets fouled from behind. That sets up a direct kick for Lepuge. And look at that bend. Just past the keeper, inside the post. Roadrunners up 1-0 in the 43rd minute. And they knew it was big because when CSUB scores first, they tend to win their soccer matches. So Lepuge with the celebration. One more look at this one coming up as Lepuge puts the nice curve on this one. Watch, it starts out to the left and then curls back to the right for the score. And that was a big one because the Roadrunners hold on to win it 1-0 and clinch a spot in the Western Athletic Conference Tournament. So Louis Lepuge with the lone goal for CSUB. He was also named WAC Offensive Player of the Week for men's soccer. The Runners with the 1-0 win lay claim to the sixth and final spot in the WAC tournament. And here's what's coming up for Bakersfield at Clyde Field in Orem, Utah. They will get going on Thursday. Now, the Roadrunners at number 6 will play third-seeded Air Force. That'll be Thursday at 3 p.m. And then you've got number 4 UTRGV, make that UNLV, and number 5 UTRGV meeting. Winner of that one sees Utah Valley. Winner of the Roadrunners and Air Force match will meet on Friday. Runners losing 3-0 earlier this year at Air Force. So the Runners are in the tournament, and you know, we caught a few of them on practice on Monday as they prepared to head to Utah.
Yeah, I mean, personally, you know, as a senior, like, I wanted, you know, this chance pretty bad, you know. I wanted one more try to get the championship, you know. My sophomore year, we were close, and this year, I just wanted one more try.
Knew before the game that a tie would be enough for us to advance, but you never play for a tie, and we wanted to win, and the first goal was really important because whenever we score the first goal, we win the game. That's how it was this season, and yeah, that's how it was on Saturday. So I think that free kick really helped us, or Louis' goal. And besides that, I don't really think they had like that much to offer on the attacking side. And we defended well, and we had the chance to score like one or two more goals. But I mean, sometimes one goal is enough, right?
Yeah, tactically, we just need to stick to our game plan. Defensively, we just need to keep a strong shape. play together, play for each other, and convert our chances when we go forward.
Yeah, we're young, so we always knew it was going to come to a time where we started to gel and get together, and you always hope to be playing your best come tournament time. So the boys have grown together. We've always stayed confident, never put too much pressure on ourselves, and I think the results started to come our way as the season went along.
So there you have it with CESUB men's soccer in the WAC tournament they will play on Thursday. Women's soccer, they were at their tournament last week in Kansas City, and the Roadrunners collecting some hardware as part of the annual yearly awards banquet prior to the start of the tournament. The WAC Digital Network cameras were there and captured some of the Roadrunners picking up some of their season awards.
One, two, three. One more. One, two, three.
The WAC Women's Soccer Banquet had plenty of photo opportunities. Seattle U collecting their fourth straight WAC Women's Soccer regular season championship.
Your 2016 champions, the Seattle U Redhawks, coached by Julie Woodward.
The Redhawks were big winners on the night. SU also had the Offensive Player of the Year in Bree Hooks. The senior led Seattle with 7 goals and 17 points on the season.
I think we're really selfless in the attack, and a lot of the times sometimes we're a little bit too selfless. We should probably be selfish more often, but I think we have a really good chemistry up there and it really works for us.
The Redhawks also had the Defensive Player of the Year as Stephanie Speakerman earns the honor. The Seattle defense allowed just 5 goals in WAC play this season.
I'm just really happy, glad that I got it, but it's a whole team effort. It starts with our forwards and then our goalies at the end of it. It's not just me.
Number 2 seed CSU Bakersfield came away with a couple of major awards. Coach of the Year is Gary Kernine. The third-year coach is honored to be selected by his peers.
Very proud to get it, and obviously with a lot of great teams here, a lot of great coaches, so thrilled to get it and very proud. But you know, it's I consider it an achievement of the team. You know, so. This group has gone above and beyond for the program over the past 3.5 months and more actually throughout the summer and the spring. So with the team and the program and the staff, it's for all of us, not just me.
Freshman of the Year goes to Sophie Freeman from CSU Bakersfield. She led WAC freshmen with 5 goals and 10 points on the season.
I was really excited. I wouldn't have gotten it without my teammates, though.
For the WAC Digital Network, I'm Eric Danner.
Runners got to go to the pitch and start playing. They're taking on Kansas City semifinals on Friday. Gary Kearney, you saw him off his Coach of the Year award. Teams walking out in tournament fashion for the start. Best 20-year record in the history of the 20-year program at CSUB. Would it end tonight? 21st minute, Lexi Howard sends the ball across, and there it is right there. Emily Herndon putting the ruse up 1-0 just like that. And then Megan Childers in the 40th minute, corner kick. It'll find the head of Nikki Pellens, and the ruse make it 2-0 off a set piece goal. Pellens making the run all the way to the bench to celebrate. CSUB on the ropes. More to come in the second half. A penalty kick as Jen Padilla was called for the penalty. She then faces the penalty kick. Emily Herndon scores her second of the match. 3-0, and the Ruse bench likes that. One more tally as the UMKC continue the onslaught. Abby Small in the 54th minute with the strike and score. 4-0 UMKC. And this one was over. Not much from CSUB in terms of offense. And this one, late attempt by Chloe Peepgrass hits the post, and CSUB will fall 4-0 in the WAC semifinals. So 8-10-4, their record. They're 4-2 one of the WAC, and it was their best overall record in the 20-year history of women's soccer, and then their best record in the Western Athletic Conference. So the Roadrunner season comes to an end in the WAC tournament. Seattle U won the WAC tournament with a 2-1 win over Kansas City in Sunday's final. On to CSUB volleyball. Runners at home having a little trouble over the weekend. CSUB on Thursday defeating Chicago State 3-0. Roadrunners hit 450 as a team in that win. Carol Grasso, 16 kills. Katie Dunbar-Lowe added 14 in the victory for CSUB. Then on Saturday, same score. Roadrunners evening the season series with UMKC with another 3-0 win. CSUB has won 6 straight matches heading into the final week of regular season play. That, by the way, is a CSUB Division I record with 6 wins in a row. Here's what's coming up for the Roadrunners. They're going to be on the road. They'll be at Seattle U Thursday at 7 p.m., and they can lock up the second seed this weekend. They'll be at Seattle Thursday, and then at Utah Valley Saturday afternoon at 1. You can watch Saturday's match live on the WAC Digital Network. Here's where it shapes out with 1 week to go in the regular season. New Mexico State, pretty much, they just need to win one game this next week, and they'll lock up that number one seed. The Roadrunners, right there at 9-3. They've got Utah Valley nipping on their heels at 8-4. They'll see the Wolverines on Saturday. So, again, the Roadrunners can lock up that number two seed this weekend. Very important for that. Then you got Kansas City, UTRGV, Seattle U, rounding out the tournament-eligible teams in the WAC. On to CESUB Wrestling. The Roadrunners opening their schedule this past weekend with a 29-12 dual victory over Cal Baptist. Coleman Hammond got the lone pin at 149 pounds. Runners dropped a couple matches early, but were able to bounce back and take care of the Lancers in their home opener. Meanwhile, the Runners will be busy this Friday at the Icardo Center. It's a tri-duel. San Francisco State will visit Bakersfield first in the early match, and then the Roadrunners will host Rutgers in the late match as well at 4 p.m. But action going on all day, basically picking up at about 11 a.m. at the Icardo Center. So you can make sure you check out Roadrunner Wrestling. Rutgers, by the way, number 12 in the nation right now. So some good Big Ten wrestlers going to be in town this weekend at this Friday at the Icardo Center. And finally, if you've been downtown recently, you've probably noticed a bit of a change in scenery to the parking structure outside of our Roadrunner Rundown studios as the city of Bakersfield and CSUB Athletics combined for a commemorative banner, so to speak, of last year's NCAA tournament basketball team with the Roadrunners and the mark of the new season. And we were there to check it out.
Go 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Here we go. And that's not it. I just asked Dietrich if he knew what was going to be on there. But this banner is a representative not just of one player. It's of this whole team and what they've done for this city. And obviously, they're going to get that tightened up, and we're going to have thousands of people to see it.
Obviously, we're proud to represent Bakersfield. We thank the city for allowing us to drop our partner banner today from NCAA tournament appearance last year. It's just, I think, the beginning of something special here. We're just so thankful for the support of the city, for our sponsors, for the alums and everyone that is supporting our program. We're looking forward to a new season.
Yeah, I mean, coming off a season like that, I mean, I'm just very blessed to have my poster put up like that, for have a team like that, for things like that to happen. So, I mean, me coming from Texas, I would have never known, like, when I came up here that I was going to get a poster hang. So I just really want to thank Coach Bourne, thank my team, thank God. I mean, it's just a dream come true.
So there you have it. You can see it at the corner of 18th and I for the next couple weeks here in downtown Bakersfield. Also, Truxton and Mohawk. There's a smaller version up as well on the Bynum and Associates building. So another one on campus of CSUB Housing. So Roadrunners popping up all over the place as the season gets underway this week. Wednesday, men's basketball hosting the Masters University, 7 o'clock in an exhibition. And then Saturday, their season opens with their season opener against San Diego Christian, 7 o'clock at the Icardo Center. Women's basketball opens on Sunday at 1 against Hawaii. We're going to step away and take a break. When we come back, we'll hear from CSUB President Dr. Horace Mitchell. We'll talk about athletics, the campus, a lot of stuff going on. We'll get an update about that coming up next. We'll be right back. This is Roadrunner Rundown.
Off the screen, Basil. 2 seconds.
What shall I do to put myself
by your side?
What shall I do to put myself along by your side?
We're Kern County, and we have a lot in which to be proud.
We connect California, power the nation, and confidently charge towards our short and long-term goals. We work hard to make our county a great place to live, learn, and dream. And anyone who calls Kern County home can help make our community stronger, schools better, and futures brighter. Together, let's turn more local dreams into realities so we can make life as it should be. Kern Schools. Together, we have something special.
We strive to achieve excellence through determination and hard work.
We are committed to learning from those around us,
our professors and peers,
our coaches and teammates,
and our opponents.
We compete with integrity and passion.
And we seize our moment when the opportunity arises.
We take pride in our communities.
And believe that we can inspire others
just as they can inspire us.
We may wear different colors, but we share the same purpose.
We learn, we compete, we inspire.
We are the Western Athletic Conference.
Basil, 2 seconds.
Basil
for the win!
Yeah! CSU Bakersfield, champions made here.
What a moment!
Last week on Roadrunner Rundown, we preview the 2016-17 men's and women's basketball seasons with head coaches Greg McCall and Rod Barnes.
We have a really good system that we've been using, and we've brought this system back. It was actually the system that we used with Ty Allen to help her be able to get some easy buckets and be able to get everybody else involved. And so we're looking forward to using that system again. I think it's going to benefit us because we are going to be pretty dominant on the perimeter again this year.
You know, we got some new guys on our team, and you're always excited about that. And, you know, just trying to build that team chemistry and trying to find out how we, you know, can best win games and, you know, trying to put guys in the right position. So it's a lot of learning, learn about the guys and then the guys learning what you want. But it's you know, it's fun because you got some older guys that kind of help during the teaching process. But it's been a lot of work, but it's been fun.
Now playing on demand on GoRunners.com. Welcome back to Roadrunner Rundown, and we continue on the program. Still to come, we'll talk some tickets. Logan Bell's into the show. We'll join us, our ticketing coordinator. A lot of things happening, but joined now in studio by CSUB President Dr. Horace Mitchell. Good to see you. Thanks so much for joining us.
Well, my pleasure, Corey. Good to see you, too.
Well, I was looking back and getting ready for this interview, and you're almost halfway through your 13th year at CSUB since arriving in 2004. Do you ever, and I've done this lately a lot for some reason, but do you ever just kind of stop and look back to your first year and think about, wow, this place has come a long way?
I do, every now and then, and it has come a long way. We've had some priorities on the campus, and we've gotten some things done, and strong support from the faculty and the staff, and strong support from our community, too. The things that I would mention in this regard is that, you know, as president, the first priority is on academic excellence. That has to be it, because that's the nature of a university. And we've spent a good bit of time making sure that we have academic programs that relate to the needs of the industries in our community. And so we've added programs in engineering, for example, electrical, computer engineering, and others. And we've added a program in agricultural business, in health and safety management, and we've just gotten final approval for our new independent doctoral degree in educational leadership. That's our first doctoral degree. And so we've been very excited about all of that. And one of the most recent changes is that we've changed our academic calendar from quarters to semesters, which we believe will be a very important part of increasing success for our students.
Yeah, and those initiatives are all, I mean, in the last few years for sure. I mean, have you kind of, when you first started, look, what was one of the biggest challenges you sort of faced right away?
You know, I don't want to sound, you know, immodest in this, but I felt that I was pretty well prepared to be the president at CSUB. And part of that was because at that point I had been in higher education for 36 years. I'd been a vice chancellor at UC Irvine for 11 years and a vice chancellor at Berkeley, you know, for just under 10 years. So 20 years as a vice chancellor. And so I looked at the job and looked at my background, and my sense was, you know, I can do this.
What about your decorated career before CSUB? What about the, you know, what did you learn of those other couple jobs that prepared you for coming here as a president?
I would say everything, in the sense that at Irvine, I was the vice chancellor for student affairs. Mm-hmm. All right. Then at Berkeley, I was the vice chancellor for administration. All right. And in both roles, I oversaw athletics, Division I athletics at Irvine, as well as Division I athletics at Cal. And so fundraising was a part of that. And of course, having been a faculty member previously and continuing in that kind of role, I felt that while my background was non-traditional in terms of moving into a presidency, because very often in the past, it's been the provost who's moved in those roles. I'd been a vice chancellor in other areas. And so, you know, it's interesting because my sense was, you know, it's like what they say about New York. So I felt if you can make it at Berkeley, you can make it anywhere. And so I've been very pleased with what we've all been able to accomplish working together at CSUB.
Sure. How much have you in the last, you know, 13 years, how have you evolved as a leader? I mean, you came in 13 years ago, and obviously you've learned a lot and things have. So how have you kind of evolved as a leader?
Interestingly, one way that I've evolved is in patience. I've always been someone who likes to get things done and move along, you know, move forward, make progress. But some things are just not under your control.
Sure.
And so, for example, I had thought that by now we would have a major office park on the campus and a hotel and conference center on the campus. And not just to have those things, but those would be ventures, public-private partnerships.
Right.
That would generate several hundred thousand dollars per year that we could then use to support our academic mission at the university. And so we got all that approved by the Board of Trustees just before the recession hit.
Right.
And so we had years of just no activity at all.
Sure.
And just as things began to come back, the oil prices went down, and that had a dramatic negative impact in this region, although it didn't have the same impact in other regions where oil and gas are not as much a part of the economy.
I think what happens is anytime we put up one of those coming soon signs, then something happens, right? Which is next time, just wait till shovels are in the ground.
Yeah. And in fact, we have the shovels in the ground right now on a new office and classroom building on the campus.
Excellent.
Which is under construction, and we expect it to be done by next summer. And we expect the faculty to move in and for classes to be held there next fall. And when that's done, we will tear down what is known as Faculty Towers, which is actually a three-story wood frame building that has deficiencies.
And no one's going to shed any, none of the faculty are going to shed any tears over that one.
No, I don't think so. They've been looking forward to this.
Yeah.
And in fact, this building has been on my list of things we needed to do for about 7 years.
Yeah.
And I told Chancellor White about 3 years ago that this was now on my bucket list, and we needed to get it done.
Yeah.
And so he helped us get it done.
Excellent. We brought up your time at Berkeley. You said that you said on the web that UC Berkeley Chancellor Dr. Cheng Lin Tien was one of your most influential in your educational career. How was that?
Yeah, well, particularly in terms of my growth as an academic leader. You know, there are other people who were more instrumental in my development as a psychologist and as a faculty member. But in terms of understanding the complexity of American higher education in broad scope, Chancellor Tien was very much the person who was the key person there. And he was the first Asian American to be appointed chancellor of a major American research university. And I enjoyed working with him. And by the time I was appointed president here at CSUB, he had passed, but his wife was here at the inauguration, and we had a chance to acknowledge her and to acknowledge him in terms of their contributions to what Barbara and I have been able to learn about being a president and first lady.
Excellent. Now, I know there have been in your tenure some challenging budget times, as we mentioned, even things you can't control like oil prices. But are you pretty satisfied with the growth of the university? Like I said, the last couple of years as things have picked back up, you know, we've been going nonstop and growing and building. And so are you, as you kind of sit back and look, are you satisfied with where, you know, where things are at and where they're kind of headed?
For the most part. And I say for the most part because our enrollment has grown faster than the state resources have been made available to support that enrollment growth.
Yeah.
And so we could have grown even more during the last number of years and into the future, but we're limited by state funding. Now, we have the opportunity to enroll more students than we're funded for, but that gets to be a slippery slope after a while because when you don't get the state funding, then you don't have the resources to hire faculty to, you know, add classrooms and things like that. So we are in a good place. We could be in a better place, but that funding issue is still there. But across the board, you know, we've just grown in so many ways. Certainly, we have outstanding folks in our faculty and staff and our administration. And in fact, as many people know, the person that I selected to be our provost and vice president for academic affairs in my second year, Dr. Sreya Kohli, is now the president of Cal Poly Pomona.
Right.
You know, and she's done a great job there. And I've said that, well, when people ask her about her background, it includes being the provost at CSU Bakersfield. And she's just one example of the kind of the people who have been here and who've moved on to the next stage of their careers, having made important contributions at CSUB.
I know you've spoken in the past, especially this year, about changing CSUB from a vision to evidence. Is this kind of the year that a lot of that came to fruition, where we're starting to see a lot of that evidence of the vision that's been in place for the last several years?
Yeah. Actually, it's been ongoing in the sense that pieces of the vision have become apparent in terms of evidence over the years. For example, our vision has three main components. One has to do with extending the excellence and diversity of our faculty, enhancing the quality of the student's experience, and strengthening our community engagement. Now, sort of from the back part of that, community engagement. Last year, we received what is called the Voluntary Engaged University Classification, which is awarded by the Carnegie Foundation for the Advancement of Teaching. And that's based on a rigorous national set of evidence-based criteria about what it is that we've been doing. And so when we were awarded this recognition, I think there were 30 others in the U.S. that were awarded that year. And overall, it's only about 300 of the 3,000 colleges and universities that have that. On the quality of the student experience part, our students identified with that portion of our vision immediately. And so we talked about having new student housing, which took a little bit longer than we thought.
Like everything else, right? Like everything else.
But it's there.
It's there.
It
yeah.
is outstanding. We also talked about, as you know, moving our athletics program to Division I. And we also talked about having a student recreation center.
Right.
And so in the spring of 2005, our students voted to provide funding to support an eventual move to Division I, and also to build what is a very outstanding student recreation center. And then our faculty increases have been delayed because of the budget.
Right.
But over the last 2 years, those have now started back again. So we've hired somewhere in the high 30s of new faculty members. So all of the pieces that we've talked about are coming to fruition, and it's a testament to the quality of our faculty and staff and the quality of students. And I would add, very significantly, the support of our community has been central to that as well.
And a lot of that, and all those kind of tied together with sort of campus culture. I know that was another strategic goal, sense of community. And you kind of like the progress on that, because I see it changing. I see the students more engaged. I see the faculty more engaged. I see staff more engaged. And has that progress well?
It really has. And I would tell you that that is something that is especially related to my experience at Berkeley. Because when I went to Berkeley, what I found was that there was a culture in the administrative side of the university that was very resistant to change. Mm-hmm. And so it took me much longer than I thought it would to change that culture. But we did see it change. Yeah. And so it was because of the importance of culture, as I had recognized it at, not only at Berkeley, but particularly at Berkeley, that we included in our strategic goals that we wanted to develop a campus culture with the sense of community and a commitment to excellence in all areas. And because, you know, I was in some discussions the other day, people were saying culture trumps, bad choice of words here, strategy all the time. In other words, you need to make sure that the right culture is in place. And once you have the right culture in place, then you can have greater success in implementing particular strategies.
Absolutely. And so far, definitely good on that front. Let's take a break. We'll come back. Got some more questions for you about the university.
Oh, absolutely.
All right. When we come back, folks, more with Dr. Horace Mitchell as we return on Roadrunner Rundown.
A masterpiece of intelligence awaits you with technologies no car has ever offered. This is the all-new 2017 E-Class from Mercedes-Benz. This new E-Class is clearly the most technologically sophisticated vehicle developed, with innovations that enhance efficiency, safety, and comfort, including the world's first fully integral car-to-X communications, providing information well in advance of imminent danger. This new E-Class carries Mercedes-Benz tradition well into the future. And you can see the all-new 2017 E-Class today at Mercedes-Benz of Bakersfield.
A Roadrunner Scholarship Fund creates educational opportunities for over 300 student-athletes at CSUB. By becoming a member and donating to the Roadrunner Scholarship Fund, you're not only helping the Roadrunners fund the scholarship needs of our teams, you're investing in the future. The Roadrunner Scholarship Fund isn't just developing student-athletes. We're developing tomorrow's leaders. From lessons learned during competition, for more information, log on to gorunners.com/donate and become a member of the Roadrunner Scholarship Fund.
Off the screen, Basil, 2 seconds. Basil for the win!
CSU Bakersfield, champions made here.
Last week on Roadrunner Rundown, we preview the 2016-17 men's and women's basketball seasons with head coaches Greg McCall and Rod Barnes.
We have a really good system that we've been using, and we've brought this system back. It was actually the system that we used with Ty Outland to help her be able to get some easy buckets and be able to get everybody else involved. And so we're looking forward to using that system again. I think it's going to benefit us because we are going to be pretty dominant on the perimeter again this year.
You know, we got some new guys on our team, and you're always excited about that. And, you know, just trying to build that team chemistry and trying to find out how we, you know, can best win games and, you know, trying to put guys in the right position. So it's a lot of learning, learn about the guys and then the guys learning what you want. But it's you know, it's fun because you got some older guys that kind of help during the teaching process. But it's been a lot of work, but it's been fun.
Now playing on demand on GoRunners.com. Welcome back to Roadrunner Rundown. Still to come, Logan Bell is going to join us from the CSUB ticket office, the ticket coordinator, as basketball season's here, and there's all kinds of ways you can come and see the Roadrunners this season, and we'll talk with him about that. But still in studio with CSUB President Dr. Horace Mitchell. Thanks for sticking around. One more segment.
Absolutely. Glad to, Corey.
We were talking a lot about growth and vision and the evidence of that. What is kind of in the – everybody likes to ask what your five-year plan is. So we've had so much happen in the last 5 years, and in your case, the last 13 years as president. So what do you kind of see for CSUB in the next 5 years?
Good question. And, you know, when you have a vision and strategic plan, I think the vision itself is a long-term aspiration of what we want for mm-hmm. the campus. And so you can always add greater expansion of academic programs in terms of academic excellence. You can always add more to the diversity of our faculty and such. You can always do things to enhance the quality of the student experience, which we're always doing, and you can always do more in terms of strengthening community engagement. So those aspects of our vision, I think, are enduring. What changes are some of the particular goals and objectives, okay? And we'll change those from time to time, and we have changed them mm-hmm. over time. And so right now we're really thinking about what should be the next set of objectives that we have consistent with our strategic plan and vision. So I don't have the exact answer for you that.
It's a work in progress.
It's a work in progress, but we've determined, as you say, that now is a good time to look at that. And one of my responsibilities, as I always say, along with the cabinet and our other senior administrators, is not only to manage and lead the university now, but also to position the university for the future. That's a critical part mm-hmm. of the responsibilities that I have along with my colleagues as president of the university. So that's something we're looking at.
Excellent. Is there any programs, whether academic or otherwise, that kind of make you especially proud, you maybe brag about when talking about CSUB to other presidents, people in the community, things like that?
Well, you know, when I came, I actually felt that in some ways CSUB was marginalized by not having academic programs that relate to the largest industries. Mm. And so we tried for years to get state funding to support agriculture, state funding to support oil programs in those areas, and no resources came. And so we met with industry executives. And so with respect to agriculture, I asked, you know, what can we do short of offering the kinds of programs that Fresno State and San Luis Obispo have in terms of major agricultural programs? Their response was, actually, we don't need any more of that. We get that from them. They said our biggest problem is that we cannot maintain the management capacity to, you know, manage the scope of our operations. And the agricultural operations here in Kern County are national and international, you know, very much so. And so we say, okay, so what can we do? And they said, well, if you had a program in agribusiness, that would be helpful. And that made a lot of sense to us. And so we developed a concentration in our Bachelor of Science in Business Administration in agricultural business. And as soon as those students got some experience and were ready to be helpful, they were picked up by the agriculture industries. And that program has now changed from a concentration to now its own Bachelor of Science degree in agricultural business.
Excellent.
We asked the same questions in oil, and we said, okay, we're not going to have the mechanical and structural and civil engineering programs others have, but again, what can we do? And they said, computer engineering, because all of their oil operations are now operated from remote computer centers, you know.
Right.
And so we said yes to that. No funding came with it, but we worked with our faculty to write proposals for grants that were successful with the U.S. Department of Education, the National Science Foundation, and others. And so we pulled together that external money to be able to start those new academic programs in engineering. And that was really, really very important to us.
Excellent. And, you know, we were talking a little bit about community engagement and things like, you know, the Bakersfield Business Conference coming back on campus this past year. The Bakersfield Marathon this weekend will start and end at CSUB. And then, of course, the various speakers with the Kegley Institute, whoever's coming on campus. But it also seems like now there's also a shift to where sort of the cultural center of the city is starting to really be around campus and people feel comfortable there, whether they're going to see somebody speak or an event and things like that.
Absolutely. And as you know, one of our tech lines is to say CSUB is your university.
Right.
And what we mean by that is that it is this community's university, whether we're talking about grade school kids coming in for a tour or high school students coming in to do research with our faculty, classes. And we have a tremendous Fab Lab, which is a whole new introduction for a lot of students to the STEM careers. Mm-hmm. And then if you're a student ready to attend college, this is your university, right? Yeah. And so we have deliberately done all that we can think of, to really enhance the community's understanding that this is the university of the community. Yeah. And we see, as you point out, evidence of that.
Yeah, for sure. And a part of that, too, on the athletics front, one of your main priorities, and you brought it up, was moving to Division One. With that, the exposure that was added. So how much have you seen that exposure sort of increase with the recent success of various athletics teams in the last couple of years?
Well, you know, I'll say a little bit more on that, because when I came to the campus for my official interview as a candidate, one of three candidates to be president, I was asked, so what do you think about us going to Division One? My answer was, I think given the history of excellence in Division Two, that moving to Division One would be a reasonable aspiration.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and that was it.
Yeah.
So then when I came back as president, they said, so what do you think about us going to Division One? And my answer was the same, except that I said, and we'll take this year to determine whether or not that is a reasonable thing for us to do.
Right.
Because it's quite an undertaking, you know, right. And it requires more resources and more staffing and whole range of things. And so, we made the decision to do that. And the fact that the students had that vote to actually add initially an additional $1 million to the athletics budget for Division One, and I had said to the students, if we didn't make the decision to go to Division One, we would refund your money.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I was pretty sure we were going to do it, you know. It took a lot. You know, it was a 5-year transition process, and Rudy Carver Hall had been very successful as our athletics director for a long time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he was instrumental in helping us then get over the hump into Division One. And I've been very pleased with it, you know. I think our fans are getting increasingly excited about CSUB athletics. I was noticing the banner right there at the building.
Can't miss it.
No, I looked out and said, "Oh wow!"
Yeah,
that's a great banner, and the success of our teams in the WAC and moving on to the NCAA has been really phenomenal. You know, and I would tell you that. And I want to really emphasize this, that when we talk about student athletes, we're talking about students who are athletes, okay? And I've said to the coaches and to the AD and Dr. Wallace, our Vice President of Student Affairs, also has said, we're interested in bringing student athletes who are good, but who also have the capacity to graduate from the university. And you'll recall that yesterday's rally and luncheon for the start of the basketball season, I was saying that we want to see students perform well in their particular athletic venue, but we also want to see them walk across the stage graduating from university. And our coaches have really done an exceptional job in that regard. Our grade point average for all athletes on average is higher than the GPA for our student body as a whole, and the APRs are well above the NCAA minimum requirements, et cetera. So I'm very proud of what we've done in athletics, and Ziggy certainly brings the leadership that helps us continue to move to the next level.
When the men's team made the NCAA tournament last year, for a non-football school like us, that's the pinnacle. There are teams that have been playing for hundreds of years that have not been to the NCAA tournament. For someone who sold that vision for such a long time, what did that feel like for you? Because that, again, was kind of the pinnacle of what we were hoping for in Division I athletics.
It was very exciting. And, of course, I was in Las Vegas, and my wife as well, with all of us fans and rooting the team on, and remembering how we lost to New Mexico State, sort of at the buzzer, and then it's like, oh, and then to see that last shot slowly going toward the basket and going in, it was outstanding, and just to see the excitement among the players, the excitement among our students, and the excitement among our fans, to me, was very satisfying because it said, that's what this is really all about. You know, it's about building a sense of community, a sense of camaraderie, and support. And it's actually mutual support across the campus.
And it was a great exposure. I mean, we were trending on Twitter that night. I mean, CSU Bakersfield was trending on Twitter, and people were kind of figuring out. The best part was people saying, who are these guys? But then they went and looked us up, and they wanted more information about who exactly was this team.
Absolutely. And I'll add more. You know, we went to, my wife and I went to the first round in Oklahoma City, and, if you read the papers, it's like, okay, CSUB is a 15 seed.
Right.
Oklahoma's a 2 seed, and they'll knock them off without any trouble.
Right.
Well, people were totally surprised, including the people there in Oklahoma City, where we were playing this
neutral
game.
Site.
Were totally surprised when we got off to an 8-0 lead. Yeah. Like, wait a minute, who are these guys?
Right.
And so they had to call a timeout and regroup. and we were very competitive all the way through the game. And they made a couple of three-pointers right toward the end that gave a spread in the score that was not typical of the score all along. So we were very, very proud of, our team and our athletics department and all the things that everybody's been doing. And I was excited in getting back to see the buses that said Go Runners and all the excitement in the city. And so you're right. For us, since we don't have football, it is success in basketball that becomes most noticeable to people. And that was very exciting. We wanted to do it again.
We want to do it again.
We want to do it many more times.
You want to go back. You can't just do it once. Dr. Mitchell, thanks so much for joining us. I appreciate your time. Great stuff. And our season's right around the corner, so fans will see you at plenty of games this year, I'm sure.
Absolutely.
All right, thanks again.
Okay.
All right, folks, when we come back, we're going to talk tickets with Logan Bells. As we said, season's right around the corner. We'll be back. It's Roadrunner Rundown.
What shall I do to put myself
by your side?
What shall I do to put myself along by your side?
For more than 75 years, Current Schools has been helping local people achieve local dreams. We have watched piggy banks emptied to reward a job well done, supported our teams, and tried our best to make life a little easier. We have been there when friends become parents, buy their family's first car, and build a home with a life to match, just like it was dreamed to be. Beyond dollars and cents is our pride of Kern County and the people who make it such a great place to call home. Together, let's turn more local dreams into realities so we can make life as it should be. Current Schools. Together, we have something special.
Introducing TBC Mobile from the Bakersfield, California. The most complete news, sports, weather, video, opinion, and lifestyle coverage in Bakersfield and Kern County. It's the easiest way to stay up to date on all things local while on the go. read it on your smartphone or tablet. Download now by searching Bakersfield Californian in the Apple, Google, and Amazon app stores.
We strive to achieve excellence through determination and hard work.
We are committed to learning from those around us,
our professors and peers,
our coaches and teammates,
and our opponents.
We compete with integrity and passion.
And we seize our moment when the opportunity arises.
We take pride in our communities.
And believe that we can inspire others
just as they can inspire us.
We may wear different colors, but we share the same purpose.
We learn, we compete, we inspire.
We are the Western Athletic Conference.
A Roadrunner Scholarship Fund creates educational opportunities for over 300 student-athletes at CSUB. By becoming a member and donating to the Roadrunner Scholarship Fund, you're not only helping the Roadrunners fund the scholarship needs of our teams, you're investing in the future. The Roadrunner Scholarship Fund isn't just developing student-athletes. We're developing tomorrow's leaders from lessons learned during competition. For more information, log on to gorunners.com/donate and become a member of the Roadrunner Scholarship Fund.
Off the screen, Basil, 2 seconds. Basil for the win!
CSU Bakersfield, champions made here.
Welcome back to Roadrunner Rundown. My thanks to CSUB President Dr. Horace Mitchell for joining us in the last segment. As you can get the show anytime on demand at GoRunners.com if you miss any of Dr. Mitchell's appearance. But we're joined now as basketball season's underway this week. We're joined now by Logan Bell's ticketing coordinator. Good to see you, man. How are you?
Great. Great, Corey. Thanks so much for having me.
I know it's kind of a busy time of year as the season starts, but it's been busy for you for a while. You guys have, in your office, have done a pretty good job updating and increasing the ticket sales this year, haven't you?
Yeah. So Parker and I have done fantastic. It's been completely busy since the summertime.
Yeah.
That's when we got together and said, you know, we're gonna pack the place out, and what's the best way to do that is to get, you know, season ticket holders on board, and due to our what Dr. Mitchell was saying about the NCAA tournament bid, you know, sort of helped out a little bit about getting season tickets on board and season ticket holders. So definitely a plus and getting everybody to the games.
Yeah,
so.
And you've had the benefit of having a little some new seats on one side of the arena. So that's kind of helped with season ticket holders as well, and a couple of those sections already sold out, right?
Yeah, so we have, for our seats, we've implemented our Plaza One, which is our $1,000 donor midsection area, which is currently 95% sold.
Wow.
We have our two outermost sections, which is our Plaza Two level, which is 55% sold, which is still a donor area of $250 to the Roadrunner Scholarship Fund. And our non-donor areas are above those two sections, which are Plaza 3 and Plaza 4. So Plaza 3, we only have single seats available there.
Wow.
And for 95, we're 95% sold through that.
Excellent.
And Plaza 4, we you know, we our other non-donor area, which is 60% sold. So
excellent.
So we're, you know, we're pushing every day and getting calls in, and hopefully those numbers change every day. So
now I know the season tickets are big, and that'll continue here for the first few weeks. But obviously, getting those groups, I know, is something that you guys do a lot of. What are some of the group initiatives that we have coming up, and benefits for a group to come out to a game?
Definitely. So we have our Ag Night, which is a big night for groups, FFA and 4-H kids in the area, in Kern County and surrounding areas, for them to come out and enjoy a great night of basketball, Ag companies and sponsors in the area, you know, sponsor those tickets for those kids to come out and enjoy.
Cool.
And that's going to be versus Utah Valley this year, January 21st. And then we have Education Day, which is going to be on December 15th, which we've already had several groups, about over 1,000 RSVP'd already, coming out for that one.
Nice.
It's at noon versus Bethesda University. And then we also have other big games such as homecoming versus Chicago State. Of course, the Fresno State matchup, the Battle of the 99, going to be here on November 22nd, which if you haven't gotten your tickets yet, please do because they're going pretty quickly.
Yeah.
And again, the New Mexico States and the GCUs. GCU is also our senior night, which is going to be at the end of the season. So that's going to be a pretty special night for everyone.
And the Education Day coming up in December, that'll be, we just basically, we tip off at noon and we let a bunch of school kids come in and take over the place. And they get, then they get campus tours and they get a little pep rally action. And last year it seemed to work very well. And we were talking off air. I said, was there 2,000 there last year? You said, no, there was 1,000. I was like, they're so loud. They sounded like 2,000. I mean, those kids never stopped the entire
exactly.
game.
what happened was last year, Bryn, when she passed out the tickets, she also passed out, little posters for them to make special posters for everyone, for them to be engaged in the game. And it was, you seemed like it was like you said, it seemed like there was 2,000 people in there for them going all crazy. I was watching our women's as they played Oregon State. And when they played Oregon State last year, it was their Education Day. And it got me going on, hey, I really want to help out and try to get more people to the game. And so we're doing really, really well this year for Education Day. So if there's any principals or teachers watching,
get
your numbers in. So,
yeah, that'd be great. And details are at gorunners.com/TIX. The Fresno State game, you brought up individual tickets for that game. That game's going to sell out. I mean, we're going to go ahead and say that now. But both teams, the NCAA tournament last year, it is a Tuesday night, but it doesn't really matter because it's Tuesday night around a holiday. How many, I guess, roughly, tickets are out or tickets are sold or whatever is left? And I mean, how many tickets basically do we maybe have left for that game, and how can people get them?
Well, we still have tickets available
as
they call into the box office. Again, we want to save our chairback seats for our donors and for people that want to add on any kind of seats for their chairback seats that they have with season tickets. But that doesn't mean that we can't get you the best seat in the house. Yeah. So definitely, I would highly encourage everyone to call in, get their tickets situated for them. We can have them up a will call, or they can come by to the iCarter Center and pick them up before the game or days before the game. Highly suggested people do that so it doesn't clog up the entrances.
Right.
And, Corey, of course, you were right. It's going to be a huge game, and the Mountain West champs versus the WAC champs. And it's going to be a great matchup here in Bakersfield. So
yeah,
it's going to be a lot of fun.
And that's definitely a big one to get a hold of. So we got groups. We got the single game tickets. And even that UC Santa Barbara game, which is next Saturday, that's going to be a big one as well. And people can get single game tickets right now for that.
Absolutely. Anyone can get any kind of single game tickets to any games they see on the schedule if they go online at gorunners.com. Or if they call into the box office here at 654 Blue, and we'd be able to get them whatever games they're interested in coming to. And that you're right, that Santa Barbara, we're having a home and home with them, and it's going to be a lot of fun. I know they are in the middle of the pack at the Big West, and so it's going to be a pretty great matchup.
And have you mentioned it earlier, but I mean, what has the response been? A little better response to you now when you're asking people to buy seats, buy additional seats, just because of the success that the men's team had last year?
Well, that's what I was talking with other people. It has that boost. It has that, that information you could back up with saying, hey, look, we have an NCAA tournament team. And I believe we still do have an NCAA tournament team this year as well, even though we lost two big guys, Ali and Kevin. We still have a good 10-year team, I think.
Yeah.
And they know what it felt like to go back there, and they want to get back there again. So I believe that we have a fantastic team this year. And it has had much success. It has people see it, and they're calling in more. But it's still on our end, on Parker and I's end, we still do the call outs, and we still do what happened last year if we didn't even make the tournament. So we don't have. It's not like we don't call out anymore, but
yeah, they are responding.
But
better
they are responding
do.
A little bit better. Yes.
Yeah. No, that's great. And again, Wednesday night, the men's team opens up. It's an exhibition against the Masters University, and then Saturday, the men's team opens up against San Diego Christian at 7. Both those games at 7, and the women's team will open up on Sunday against Hawaii. So the way to get a hold of Logan, gorunners.com/TIX in your number
is 661-654-2361, or you can call in 654-BLUE.
All right, all the details online as well. Logan, thanks for joining us, man. Appreciate it.
Hey, no problem, Corey.
All right,
thanks,
thank
man.
You. Thank you, folks, for joining us as well. You can get the show anytime on demand at GoRunners.com. If you missed any of Dr. Mitchell's interview, you can check that out as well. I'll be out next week. Marcus Brown is going to join us. He's going to be filling in as our guest host as I'm traveling with men's basketball. And then on November 22nd, we'll be on location on campus for a special Roadrunner Rundown sort of game day edition as the Roadrunners host Fresno State that Tuesday night, the 22nd. So we'll be back on that date as well on campus. And then Marcus filling in next week on the program. So we will catch you then. Thanks so much for joining us, folks. This has been Roadrunner Rundown.
Off the screen, Basil, 2 seconds.